3 abstentions. The question is not agreed by the majority of each of the 2 groups of members present. I declare the motion negatived. This council is now in committee stage. Members may refer to the appendix to the script for the debate and voting arrangements for the bill. I will now first deal with the clauses with no amendment. I now propose a question to you, and that is that the following clauses stand part of the Medical Registration Amendment Bill 2016. Clauses 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 9, 12, 13, 14. Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Ray Chan. Thank you, Chairman. We have about 4 hours left today, and we have just begun the first debate, that is, for clauses without amendment. Now, although there are no amendments to these clauses, I think many members will have a lot to say on these clauses. Oh, please, don't take away my bill as I speak. And I see this paper handed down by chairman to members that, in fact, in relation to these clauses without amendments, there are problems. For example, Clause 6 amends Section 14 about limited registration. I think I'll come to that when I speak again. I need to ask members of the Bills Committee and Dr. Leung Ka-lau in particular about limited registration in this section. Originally, this clause carries no amendment, and yet recently we have heard things about lowering the threshold for introducing mainland doctors. And I thank Chairman for handling Clause 6 separately. And another strange point is that we now have another clause without amendment, Clause 9, which amends Section 20B in relation to the Health Committee. One of the 4 will be repealed to be substituted by 2 of the 8 members. And I'm going to speak on Clause 9 without amendment. Now, first of all, we're going to vote on Clause 4 before we vote on Clause 9. Clause 4 has to do with amending Section 3, with establishment and composition of the Council. And this is the core issue in relation to the reform of Medical Council, and that is to increase the number of lay members from 4 to 8. So why must we take out Clause 9 when we vote on this? Because it is supposed to be dealt with in the next debate. So only after we debate and vote on that can we understand whether we agree to increase the number of lay members from 4 to 8. However, now Clause 9 is jumping the gun, as there is no amendment in Clause 9, and that is to increase the number from 1 of the 4 to 2 of the 8. Now the problem is, by that time, won't have even agreed to increase it to increase the number of lay members from 4 to 8. So how come the change to 2 of the 8? I have no alternative but to disagree with Dr. Leung Ka-lau, because logically speaking, it doesn't work. Because the next clause should be about the addition of 4 lay members to the total of 8. So how can we debate on the next clause, Clause 9, to change it to two of the eight, so that there are eight members. Can you say that we are not careful enough? Was this issue even identified at the stage of the Bills Committee? Let's look at the bill again. Mr. Albert Ho says that it's up to the administration to arrange for the order of voting or the legal advice of the Legislative Council. Does that mean that they have all neglected this flawed logic? And in fact, the voting arrangements have been announced weeks ago. So no one really read the script carefully. No one discovered this flawed logic. Isn't it outrageous? I'm not a member of this bill's committee. And only about 2 months ago did I start to read this bill very carefully. But only not until this week did I discover this flaw in the logic. Now let's say if clause 4 is passed, we will then proceed to debate on clause 9 in the next debate. But in this debate, we should first deal with this. And I think we should be able to discuss clause 9 in this debate first. Clause 9 is about amending section 20V. That is about the functions of the health committee, Dr. Lau, you were trying to say what? Point of order. Call for quorum.
Mr. Chen Chi-chun, please continue. Thank you, Chairman. I continue to speak on Clause 9 with no amendment. Amending Section 22E, U Health Committee. Although there is no amendment to this clause, but there is some problem with the logic because we only vote on it after we have amended Clause 4. To follow my logic, I think you really have to look at the original provision. We'll talk about the Health Committee. First, we have to understand what is meant by the Health Committee and also its terms of reference and functions. I'd like to take this opportunity to take the Medical Council to task because I looked up the website of the Medical Council hoping to find some information. Of course, it is very outdated and there is only the English version. The only Chinese characters we can see is Han Gong Yi, Sao Jun Yi, Wu Se Quan, which means ensuring justice, maintaining professionalism, and protecting the public, respectively. So for ordinary members of the public, if they like to understand more about the Medical Council from its website, it is not an easy task. I hope that the Medical Council can review this and ensure they provide a bilingual website. All right, what is meant by the Health Committee? It is a committee to deal with challenges against a medical practitioner, whether he is still fit to practice because of his health conditions. At first, I was thinking that it was about patients and operates under the procedures set out in the disciplinary procedures regulations. Now, under the relevant provision, chairman of the PIC and also the health committee will see whether the complaint is frivolous and ungrounded. If yes, there is no need to proceed. And if they are of the view that because of the physical medical condition of a doctor, his fitness to practice is in question, then such issues should be directly considered by the Health Committee under the Medical Council. The case can be referred to the Health Committee and recommend that a committee conduct an inquiry. If chairman and vice chairman of the PIC is of the view that a complaint should be fully considered by the PIC, then the PIC will conduct a preliminary hearing and a preliminary consideration and will make recommendations to the Medical Council as to whether a full inquiry should be held. And if the PIC thinks that the fitness of the doctor to continue to practice is questioned because of his medical and physical condition, then the part or whole of the case can be referred to the Health Committee for hearing.
I hope you first understand the jurisdiction of the Health Committee. That is only one of the jurisdictions. I won't read out everything. If you want to know more, please refer to Section 20B. This is bracket 1A of 20B only. Then we come to some very difficult mathematics. I don't know whether you have the ordinance with you, Mr. Chairman. It's a more difficult mathematical question than what you wrote in the papers recently. We are talking about changing the number of members at the Health Committee. Let us see how the Health Committee is composed. According to Section 20U of the ordinance, they are elected amongst members of the MC. The chairman must be a member of the MC, first of all, but it doesn't say whether this should be a doctor or not. We have to be clear about this. This is Condition A. Condition B, there should be two other MC members who are elected from amongst members of the MC. In other words, together with the chairman, there will be three members of the MC elected from amongst MC members.
And it doesn't say whether these are doctors, because at the MC, even in the existing system, we have four lay members in the MC. The third condition, two non-MC member registered doctors, and they should be nominated by the Hong Kong Medical Association. Condition D, one non-MC member registered doctor nominated by the Director of Health. E, one non-MC member registered doctor nominated by the hospital authority. These four forming a group are doctors. C, D, and E are doctors, but they are not members of the MC, and they are nominated by the Hong Kong MA, the D of H, and the HA. The F condition is 1 to 3 persons who are considered appropriate by the MC but who are non-MC members. Again, it doesn't say whether these are doctors. No, they are 1 to 3 persons regarded to be suitable persons by the MC, but they are not MC members. You have heard me for so long. How many people are there? It is just addition and subtraction. Dr. Leung Ka-lau, don't laugh. Chairman, a point of order. I don't know whether we have a quorum. I will let you think about this mathematical question. Mr. Ray Chan, please continue. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, I was trying to add up the membership for you. That's the membership of the Health Committee. Why is this important? Let us look at Section 20, U bracket 3. It says this quorum for the Health Committee, you know, quorum is very important. We need a quorum. The quorum for the Health Committee is 5, with conditions, including the chairman. There must be the chairman. And the second condition is that there must be at least one lay member. And then another condition is that amongst these 5, over half of them should be medical doctors. My question was, how many members are there at the Health Committee? First of all, the chairman, plus 2 members, all 3 from the MC, and 4 non-member medical doctors nominated by 3 institutions, so 7, and then 1 to 3 non-members. In other words, 8 to 10. Anywhere from 8 to 10. Sorry, I have not even come to the most important point. And that is G, which is not amended. The one of the 4 lay members of the MC. I'd like to ask the question, is this an extra member on top of the 10? Or is it that under AB, in other words, the chairman plus the 2 MC elected members, if there is already a lay member among these 3, because there are already 4. In other words, at least 8 persons. But if that is not the case, if G is an extra condition, I would disregard whether it is 8 or 10 from A to G. I will have to add 1 or 2. Well, I will continue later. Thank you. Dr. Dennis Kwok, or Mr. Dennis Kwok. Chairman, in the first debate, we are going to debate the clauses that are not amended, but I'd like to talk about Clause 7 of the Blue Bill, which is about the PIC. There is now 1 PIC, but there will be 1 or more PICs. This is a very important clause, even if it is not amended. Not many members commented on this clause during this debate. But this is an improvement introduced by the administration to tackle the backlog of complaints of medical incidents. Well, I don't disagree that if you have 1 more PIC or more PICs, of course that will help tackle the backlog of 900 cases. But this is not the right way to go to tackle the biggest problem we have. At the second reading debate, I said that at present, in the first stage hearing of the PIC, that is taking 17 months, and that is only about the first stage vetting. It is a huge waste of time. And I also said that I do not agree with one graph of the Medicine Sans Bihe saying that out of the 17 months, 11 months are for doing administrative work. So it has nothing to do with the efficiency of the membership. No. There is a definite relationship between the two, because the PIC chairman and deputy chairman should be held most responsible. You can't just dismiss it as administrative procedures.
Screening,
because during the first stage screening, the chairman and the vice chairman of the PIC have very clear roles, and it's rather simple, is that they have to determine whether the complaint is a frivolous or vexatious complaint. If it is not one, then they must immediately refer the complaint to the entire PIC for an overall scrutiny. So there's no reason why the first stage should take 17 months. And we can see that the backlog, where its most serious problem lies, is in the first stage. Some 700 cases are still in the first stage. In some other professions, there are similar first stage proceedings of the PIC, but how come that for other professions they can work on them speedily, but then for the medical sector there is a backlog of 700 cases in the first stage? How come that the chairman and the vice chairman can't deal with them? Why can't they hold meetings more frequently? Why are they just circulating papers? Why are they sitting there just waiting for the secretary to do work for them? And they are dragging the cases for 17 months. I don't see any response from the medical sector and Dr. Leung on this. And they said that it's just an administrative procedure and it takes 17 months. That kind of explanation is most unconvincing. Now, if doctors are against this bill, they must come out to explain clearly why the first stage of the PIC takes 17 months. Now, in fact, whether it's the courts in the UK or in Hong Kong, there have been cases where the judges have made comments on the first stage of the PIC. What is the work of the first stage of PIC? I must explain this. In the UK, our V General Counsel ex parte talk case, and that was a case under the old system. They have now changed the system, and it's not like ours now anymore. And at that time, the system was scrutinized by the courts in detail, and they explained how the first stage of PIC works. And the ruling is that
in the Act and the rules to which I have referred are designed to protect the public from the risks of practice by practitioners who, for any reason, whether competence, integrity, or health, are incompetent or unfit to practice, and to maintain and sustain the reputation of the public and the public confidence in the medical profession. The public have higher expectations of doctors and members of other self-governing professions, and their governing bodies are under a corresponding duty to protect the public against the incompetent as well as the deliberate wrongdoer. Serious professional misconduct includes serious negligence, and whether the treatment of a patient constitutes serious professional misconduct is to be judged by the proper professional standards in the light of the objective facts that about the individual patient in question. The Act and the rules set out to provide a just balance between the legitimate expectation of the complainant that the complaint of serious professional misconduct will be fully investigated, and the need for legitimate safeguards for the practitioner who, as a professional person, may be considered particularly vulnerable to and damaged by the unwarranted charges made against him.
Well, the provisions are clear. They have to strike a balance between the interest of the patients and the doctor's reputation. And the public have the reasonable expectation if there is any professional misconduct on the part of the doctors, such acts must be thoroughly investigated into and an answer must be given. And the doctors must also, to a certain extent, be protected as well, because doctors may be subject to some frivolous or vexatious complaints. So the first stage of the PIC is to really to strike a balance between the two. And then, like Manjel, the judge also in the ruling also explained it.
Screener is a narrow one. This screener is talking about what? This is the first level of the first stage.
Well, the screener is the person who is doing the screening in the first stage of the PIC.
Out from the formally correct complaints, not those which in his view ought not to proceed further, but those which he is satisfied for some sufficient and substantial reason need not proceed further. For this purpose, he must be satisfied of a negative, namely that the normal course of the complaint proceeding to the PIC need not be followed. The assumed starting point is one above, and the need
refer to is the need to honor the legitimate expectations that the complaints will proceed through to the PPC and to the inquiry. The absence of need of which a screener must be satisfied before he can hold the normal course of the complaint to the PCC connotes the absence of any practical reason for the complaint to so proceeding, and that for the complaint to proceed to the PCC would serve no useful purpose. There may be no need because there's nothing which the law amounts to a complaint, because the formal verification is lacking, because the matters complained of, even if established, cannot amount to serious professional misconduct, because the complainant withdraws the complaint, or because the practitioner has long ceased to be registered. Why the question as to the prospects of the success of the complaint, as to whether the complainant is acting oppressively, or as to the justice of the investigation proceeding further, do not lie within the screener's remit, so far as they may go to the issue of whether the complaint ought to proceed, they fall within the remit of the PIC in the second stage.
为什么我读这一段出来呢？就是因为其实就是解释了究竟点。
Why did I read this ruling out? Because the chairman of the vice chairman of the first stage of the PIC should play a very great role to explain why we now need 17 months to deal with a simple procedure as this one. The court ruling just I quoted said that they have a narrow discretion. They just have a role to look at complaints which are considered vexatious and frivolous and which cannot be substantiated. What do we mean by vexatious and frivolous? Say, for example, the complainant is complaining against the look of the or the design of the tie of the doctors, then that can be screened out. Or the complainant has not filled in his name properly in the form or filled out the full set of information on the form, and the complaint cannot be verified. And at the first stage, such complaints can be screened out immediately. And also, in other cases, maybe the doctors have passed away and the doctors are not practicing anymore. For these complaints, they can be screened out immediately. So in the first phase, if you look at, if you identify or see that there is a complaint case like that, and if you are satisfied that this patient has seen this doctor and you can verify the patient records and you can see that the complaint is not vexatious or frivolous, then under the law, you must refer the case to the full PIC, i.e. to the second stage for scrutiny. So, Secretary, what I want to say is that I understand why you want to add in an additional PIC. You want to have more people participating in the process. But the question is, if the chairman and the vice chairman are not playing their role properly and they don't understand what they are required to do under the law, then these 700 odd cases will still be in the backlog. If they don't know what they should do, and they are dragging or procrastinating, and they don't know what their duties under the law are, even if you have, say, 4, 5, or 6 PICs, that won't be of use. If, say, the chairman and vice chairman of these other PICs will act like the existing chairman and vice chairman of the existing PIC, they are stalling cases, they are not dealing with the cases proactively, they are just doing circulation of papers, asking the secretariat to do the work for them and seek legal advice, and that will not be of use. Well, sometimes they said that in the first stage they need to seek legal advice. What kind of legal advice do they need? In the first phase, you don't need any legal advice. We are not talking about an inquiry or the second phase of PIC. You are just in the first phase. You should just be checking whether the information in the form is proper. You look at whether the complaint is vexatious or frivolous. If that is not the case, then you must immediately refer the case to the second phase of the PIC. That is what they are required to do under the law. Now, some doctors have certain duties in the HK MCHK. Well, I hope that they can come out to explain what they have done as chairman and vice chairman of the PIC. Why do they need 17 months? Have you fulfilled your responsibility properly? What shouldn't you be held accountable? Before you say that there should not be any amendment to the ordinance and there should not be any reform to the council. If you are a doctor and you are a member of the MCHK and you are the chairman of the PIC, I hope that you can do a job properly and you are being responsible in your job. The ruling of the court sets out clearly your responsibilities and you have to follow what is required going by the ruling and also the legal procedures. Well, 17 months is not acceptable at all. So I hope the secretary, please don't think that you can address the or ease the backlog of the 700 cases in the first phase just by adding just one more PIC. That won't help. There will still be a backlog of cases in the first phase. My time is running out. And in a minute, I will be talking about how the UK is reforming its complaint handling mechanism so that there will not be so much time to be spent on the first phase, and also the chairman and vice chairman don't have to look at the same case twice. And that is the first phase will be contracted out to somebody to work on, so that the whole process can be expedited. Thank you, Chairman.
The original legislative intent of the Medical Registration Ordinance was, I quote, to consolidate and amend the law by making more comprehensive provisions regulating the registration of practitioners in medicine and surgery, end of quote. One of the objectives are to maintain the standards of practice in medicine and surgery through the complaint system by making the practitioners accountable for their professional performance. However, the complaint system of the Medical Council is notorious in adequate and efficient. It is time-consuming and ineffective, as seen in the case of Law U.Y. Ray and Medical Council of Hong Kong, chairman and the deputy chairman of the Preliminary Investigation Committee of the Medical Council, and Dr. Chan Yi-Sing Alvin, where the complaint took 2 years to get past the first screening stage and another two to be rejected by the PIC. Another example would be Chang Song Tak Peter, a very famous singer. His case, it took him nine years to decide that the doctor in the case was guilty of professional misconduct. Cases like this trigger the present discussion, that is the Medical Registration Amendment Bill 2016. Mr. President, for me to continue my discussion and this debate, I believe I have to provide some background information on the current system of complaint. The current system is a three-stage system, and the first stage involves a screening to be done by chairman or the deputy chairman single-handedly, who will consider whether the case is groundless or flawless. If so, he has the authority to dismiss the case. This is supposed to be a prompt appraisal of a complaint to remove an obvious case that is groundless and should not proceed further. However, as was seen in Law U.Y. and Medical Council of Hong Kong, the third stage can take up to 2 long years. Mr. President, we are talking about some very helpless victim and their families, and it took them 2 years to go through the first stage. At this stage, screeners are entitled to consider not only the specific complaint and the supporting materials as a whole, which they should do fairly and reasonably, but also to consider where there is any other matter or allegation that may appear to raise a question about the medical petitioner's professional conduct. The underlying rationale for the screening process under the scheme was explained clearly in the case of Dr. Leung Kam Chong Kenneth and Medical Council of Hong Kong, where it was stated clearly that it was to ensure that medical petitioners are not vexed with complaints which might turn out after inquiry to be groundless. And since the role of the first stage screeners is a very narrow one, which requires them to filter out complaints which they are satisfied should not proceed further, he must be satisfied of a negative in that the normal course of the complaint proceeding to be to the PIC should not be followed. As at this stage, Mr. President, if I may pause here and echo the honourable member of the legal constituency, Mr. KWOK, what he said earlier in his speech. We see a lot of problems happening at this very first stage. Number one, the chair, he has to single-handedly handle all these cases. And I will further elaborate on this particular point in the later part of my speech. Now, we move on to the second stage. If the complaint is not dismissed after the first check, then we come to the second stage. There will be a check by the PIC, and there will be conducted as to whether or not to refer the case for inquiry and determination by the counsel for inquiry. This is a very detailed consideration of the complaint and where the medical petitioner can submit information in response. The purpose of this stage is to seek the view of the lay member of the PIC so that a complaint is also looked at from a lay person's point of view. If the PIC is eventually satisfied that there is a prima facie case, they will refer the case to the counsel for the counsel's final examination. Now, Mr. President, we spot four very major issues of why this system is currently so ineffective and unsatisfactory, not only to all stakeholders. We are talking about the patients, victims' family, we're talking about petitioners, and of course, the public in general. First, as I mentioned earlier, the chairman and deputy chairman, they are both full-time practicing doctors. And as we know, they have a very limited time to spend on their duties with the medical council. And this is the main reason for the delay in inquiries, because they simply do not have the time to do their work. Of course, as the honourable member of the legal constituencies mentioned earlier, some of these chairmen and deputy chairmen, they might overlook the case, they might spend more time, more than necessary of time on these issues. Their job is supposed to look at whether there's a prima facie case, whether it is groundless, and move on. Some of them would have abused their powers. So, that is to say, the bill could have solved this problem if we make the chairman or deputy chairman that position or that office a full-time position, or at least allowing the chairman or the deputy to delegate their responsibility in first screening to a professional. That is, there could be a lawyer, there could be any other person who is able to take up the job in an efficient manner. And by what I mean efficient manner, that is, Mr. President, justice. And we all understand justice delay is justice denied. Secondly, the chairman and deputy chairman, as well as PIC, they often sit to do more than they have to do. And I refer to what I said earlier. Their job is to examine whether the case is groundless. But very often, as seen in many, many cases, some of them were reported in court, that they end up actually doing the examination, whether there's a bridge or whether the applicant has a reasonable chance of winning, and which takes up more work, time, and effort. It is not for the first stage screeners to arrogate to themselves the role of the PIC and decide whether the complaint should be referred to the council for inquiry. Still less to arrogate to themselves the role of the PIC and weigh up conflicting evidence or judge the prospect of success. In this aspect, the bill, and we are talking about even after with the amendment, would not help to solve the situation because the chairman or deputy chairman will still have to do the work. What may help solving the problem is to employ a full-time chairman, as I mentioned earlier, and to provide more training on what they should be doing. Another source of delay is when medical expert opinion has to be sought from outside council. That is, they have to seek a lot of medical expert opinions from other practitioners. If allegations involve specialist knowledge, and this takes up time, and usually it could take up years and years of expert opinions, because they have to identify an appropriate expert as a first step, then they have to speak to the expert, then the expert will take time to find out the problem, identify the issues, and write up their reports, which could take up another long time. And that expert who would be willing to provide assistance to the council for this particular purpose. Also, Mr. President, lay members of the council may take longer time to study and consider allegations involving medical evidence. And that makes perfect sense. Even in this chamber, we have only a few doctors. And how would us expect lay members of this medical council would have the expertise equal to their counterparts in the medical council to have the expertise to digest and understand all these materials within a short period of time? So, I was going to suggest, Mr. President, that when it comes to the PIC stage, when all these lay members, it takes them a long time to study the materials before the real issues have yet to be crystallized, we have all these delays. And as I suggest to the Secretary, this bill with the amendment, even eventually the Council passed it, even if it becomes law, it will not help what is happening right now. It will not bring justice to those victims' family because we have all these problems right now. The problem with this bill, as I mentioned, is it failed to address all four of the above-mentioned questions that need answering urgently. However, it is a bill that proposes some form of reform which is urgently needed to maintain a high standard in the practice of medicine and surgery, and to reduce chances for cases such as Law Yu Wai and Zheng Xiong Tak to happen again. The court has more than once, Mr. President, criticized the current system. And no doubt, we understand and we give credit to the Secretary and his colleagues. They are trying to bring reform. But is this adequate? Is this something we need? Is this reform something that can really solve the problem that is currently happening? I beg to differ. Reform should have taken place a long, long time ago. The General Medical Council of the UK began their process to reform decades ago, and they published 6 reports. Their final reports came in 2005, namely the shipment inquiry. And I shall refer to this shipment inquiry in my submissions, in my speeches later. And that shipment inquiry means that Hong Kong is almost 11 years behind. We should not have to wait for further misfortune to happen for us to really take a crack at what is now the defect of our system. But Mr. President, we see that the Medical Council doesn't only need a small reform like our bill, like this amendment bill. We need a big reform. We need something groundbreaking. We need something that can really change the fundamental system of this medical council. As a professional myself, I fully understand the fears. I fully understand how painful it could be to a professional if he or she is alleged of professional misconduct. I can fully understand that. And that is why, precisely the point, why this small step of reform is not enough, is not sufficient, and in fact, it brings a lot of harm to our current system. It's just not enough. Mr. President, before I finish my speech, may I make a suggestion, a sincere suggestion to the Secretary. If the Secretary is wholeheartedly in support of a reform, may I urge him to take the advice made by the Honourable Member of Kowloon East, Mr. Alan Leung, made yesterday. There's still a chance to make a reform, and there's still a chance that this bill to be passed at this stage. I rest my case for now.
孟孟靖議員.
Okay. 主席,
Ms. Claudia Mo, Chairman, I have a point of order. Did you say that you had some strong views about the ornament on Mr. Lung Kwok Hong's hair? Why is it so objectionable? I've also had my ornament here. I'm of the view that it is not solemn enough for Mr. Lung Kwok to wear his hat into this chamber. We have this rule of procedure. We must be properly attired when in this chamber. I'm of the view that Mr. Lung Kwok Hong's attirement is not really proper. What does that, by properly attired, do you would you rule out pants and shorts? Well, it is up to the president to decide. All right, that's correct. It's my say. Dr. Leung Ka-lau, I have a point of order. Do we have a quorum here?
Thank you.
Ms. Claudia Mo, please speak. Mr. Chairman, the Medical Registration Amendment Bill 2016 should be the bill with the highest stack of papers sent to me amongst all the bills I have scrutinized in the past 4 years. And if you want to understand all the contents of those papers, it really takes a long time because the presentation is, say for example, I'd like to address Clause 6 because I know there is a problem with Clause 6. Clause 6 amends Section 14A, and it asks you to go to page 728. And indeed, I can see that now. It says it would amend Section 14A amended bracket, limited registration bracket, and then Section 14A, 3A, and 7A, repeal 1 year, substitute 3 years. If you do not have the clause with you, then you won't understand what is meant by repeal 1 year, substitute 3 years. I hope our council, I understand the secretariat has a hard time working here, but if in the first debate we do not have the basic wording principles and the changes for each clause, it will be very difficult. Maybe you can put all that into one page so we don't have to flip the pages. Clause 6 has to do with the validity of limited registration of doctors for it to be relaxed from 1 year to 3 years. It doesn't sound like it has a problem. If you have a query, people will accuse you of protectionism, that you want to uphold protectionism amongst doctors. No. I have read this Medical Registration Amendment Bill 2016. My starting point is, please, can you, if you want to talk, please, talk in a low voice. Members, quiet, please. Well, maybe they were not aware of the situation. In fact, their voices would not go into the audio tape, but I was distracted.
Mr. Xin Cheng Kai often chats loudly when others are speaking, so Mr. Xin, please keep quiet. Chairman, when I read through this bill, I would like to summarize my perspective, and that is to public interest, to protect public interest. We're talking about public health care services here, and they are very important. It's a matter of life and death. And if you say you are supporting the doctors, then you are supporting the notion of doctors protecting the doctors themselves. Now, everyone has dealings with doctors. Since the time you were born, you have dealings with doctors all your life. And the amendment has to do with doctors working in the public sector, and that has nothing to do with the private sector, private practitioners. Well, the pro-establishment members, they may not have to patronize services in public system, so they don't understand what's happening within the public system. Now, you are saying that we would extend the term of limited registration from 1 year to 3 years. What's the problem with that? Why have you to do this relaxation? If a non-locally trained doctor returns to Hong Kong and
if he can work for 3 years and then he can get a renewal for 3 years, and then on top of that, then an extra year will bring him the status of Hong Kong permanent resident. That's another matter, but it has to do with public interest of in Hong Kong. I've checked how limited registration works in other places. Say, for example, in British Columbia, in Canada, limited registration is done on a one-off basis and it lasts for only 6 months. So why? We want to lengthen it. If something's not broken,
咁又要諗一諗啦，哦，有道理嘅就。
You may say that it comes with good justification if overseas doctors are brought into Hong Kong and then they registration is renewed year by year, then that's quite troublesome. 3 years is better because they don't have to do it once every year. So that's reason number one. And reason number two is that, say, if people are brought in just for 1 year, then they might not like it. They would, because people have to, say, uproot themselves from another country and then come to Hong Kong, then they might not like it. So if we have 3 years, then that will give people the feeling that they may be able to be anchored here. Under the limited registration system, have you heard any views from doctors that they don't like this existing system? They have complaints and they find it a nuisance. Well, basically, they are asked to just sign on a form once every year. Then that shouldn't be any problem unless you run into some kind of serious problems. Well, the medical school of Hong Kong, Dr. Gabriel Leung, Professor Gabriel Leung is also on limited registration. What's the problem with that? So people will naturally suspect whether the relaxation will serve to attract more overseas doctors to come to Hong Kong. And that brings up a great worry of the medical sector, where what you mean by overseas doctors in fact means mainland doctors. Well, maybe that kind of generalization is not fair. You are painting everyone with the same brush. So if I refer to mainland doctors, then I may harbor some evil intentions. That may not be fair. But then this is human nature, President. Well, in the international community, say, for example, in the tourism industry, overseas nations have some complaints against mainland tourists. But you can't blame them. Well, Hong Kong tourists in overseas countries are also regarded as mainland tourists, and you might be treated impolitely. Well, that's unfortunate. But then, without good justifications and reasons, why should we be extending the term of limited registration from 1 year to 3 years? There is an example that I want to quote. New York. Limited permit to practice lasts for 2 years, is one more year than Hong Kong's situation. And renewal is allowed for only once, so a doctor can stay 4 years, the maximum. So that's for New York, the state of New York. Of course, there might be some sort of protectionism in every city. For whatever labor issues that we discuss, labor representatives will have views all the time. They are against import of labor. When we look at projects like the XRL, Hong Kong, Zhuhai, Macau Bridge, we say that we are running short of workers all the time. But then labor representatives would always say that we should protect the interest of locals workers, and they might not like import of workers. Chairman, is that is there something that you want to say to me? It seems that you want to stop me. Well, please continue, because you are looking me in a very focused way. You seem to be you look as if you want to say something, but then you didn't say anything. Clause 6, Chairman. Originally, I thought that there shouldn't be any problem because there was no amendment proposed. In fact, there was an amendment proposed by Dr. Leung Ka-lau, but then there were so many amendments from him, so you dismissed them all at one go. To my understanding, in public hospitals, there are also mainland doctors practicing. There are good and some bad mainland doctors, of course. When I was doing research, I noticed that there were cases of mainland doctors. Of course, some mainland doctors are good doctors. I understand that there are already some mainland doctors in public hospitals. They are on the side of Dr. Leung Ka-lau, and I have reasons to believe that mainland doctors already practicing in Hong Kong can understand better the mainland situation, and they all the more they think that we should defend professional autonomy of the medical sector in Hong Kong. It's not the case that we should not have any views on professional autonomy of doctors. Now, if the system is manipulated by the government, then that's very worrying. It's just like press freedom. Well, people are deterred from, say, making any remarks that would impinge on press freedom. But we still have to have regard to professional ethics in the sector. Some people said that, well, if you are so confident about yourselves, you should not be worried that Hong Kong government will interfere. Well, if that is the kind of attitude people have, that's most worrying. Because we should be abiding the principle of self-determination of the Hong Kong people. So if you are not worried about the government regulating you, then the government will indeed regulate you, and then there is no need to scrutinize the bill. Well, you can allow them to regulate you as in any way they like. So that kind of a remark is nonsensical. If I remember correctly, that remark comes from someone from the insurance sector, which, can you remember? Well, Chen Kinpo, I recall now. I jotted down what he said, but I didn't jot down the name of the legislator making that remark. I was stunned by his remarks. He said that you are worried about the situation, and you are afraid that your professional autonomy will be undermined. But if you are confident about yourself, then you don't have to worry. Now, what kind of remark is that? Well, I am confident about myself, so come and regulate me. What kind of attitude or stance is that? That's totally unacceptable. Well, you would not say that the journalists are very confident about themselves. So the government, you can set up a news authority to regulate us. That can apply to all sectors, engineering sector, legal sector, the government. Well, you welcome the government to regulate you.
As long as you are confident about yourself, you will not get worried. So this amendment relating to Clause 6 is very dubious and worried, and I would like to hear from the government's explanation on why there is this relaxation. Of course, they will say that we don't have enough doctors, they won't want to have more doctors. I will speak on that point further in the next round. Dr. KWOK Ka-ki, this is a debate about clauses with no amendment, which is less controversial. But despite that, there are still a lot of controversies on this. Let me first focus on Clause 6, and that is to extend the term of limited registration from 1 year to 3 years. I heard a lot of the public concerns saying that there aren't enough doctors in Hong Kong, and people standing in the way of the bill have ulterior motives, and there would not be fewer overseas doctors coming to Hong Kong. In 2014, there are 74 doctors from all over the world are allowed to practice in Hong Kong after taking a licensing examination. And in the same year, the two medical schools of the two universities, there are some 300 graduates. So that means it takes a high percentage of the total number of doctors, new doctors, 20% or so. And for this group of doctors in 2014, 38 are from the mainland, while in 2014, 38 mainland doctors passed the license exam. So there is no obstacle in the weight of these doctors. In the first part of the exam, 2014, four Australian doctors took the clinical exams 100%. Belgium, Irish, 100%. Mainland doctors, part three, 45% only. So the pass rate is very high. Some countries of 65%, Irish, Belgium, and so on, their pass rate is 100%. For those sitting the exams, they have never complained that this is an unfair exam. There are three parts: professional knowledge, while the pass rate is very high. Nepal, 100% pass rate. And also English test, proficiency test, the pass rate is also very high. For most countries, 100%. And for mainland graduates, 57% in the pass rate for part one. So the licensing examination is not an obstacle for those who want to practice in Hong Kong.
Never. Because we have to be a good gatekeeper, not for the interests of anyone in Hong Kong. Now, if we're going to relax the arrangements and grant them exam-free licensing, then if we create a big window out of this very high passing rate examination to allow more people to practice in Hong Kong, you may think that superficially the problem is solved. But I'd like to point out some problems to you. Well, we have a lot of affluent and privileged members here. Well, they rarely patronize public hospitals. They go to private hospitals, and Tommy Jung like to consult a doctor overseas, and people like Mr. Tam and Mr. Tang, they go to public hospitals, they are given privileges, they don't have to queue up to wait for their turn. But for most of us who visit a public hospital, most of us do not have the choice. We don't have the opportunity to seek a second opinion. We rely on this mechanism to ensure the doctors serving in our public sector in particular are up to a standard to help patients seeking medical attention. If we do not, play, we do not be a good gatekeeper. What is there for the medical council to do? And in the bills committee, we do not see any argument over the EC of the license examination. Professor Gabriel Leung, as we all know, the dean of our School of Medicine in Hong Kong, was registered in Hong Kong by limited registration for many years when I was involved. Well, I was involved in approving his limited registration here. We felt that he was the right candidate to contribute to our medical sector in Hong Kong, given that he's such a distinguished doctor. We have never made life difficult for these doctors. However, the bill fails to allay the concerns of the public. There are more and more rumors. Well, you may call them ungrounded, affecting their decision. Just a few days ago on the internet, we found advertisements on the mainland. The so-called tutorial, those tutorial websites spread the rumor that Hong Kong is going to relax the examination standard for registration of overseas trained doctors in Hong Kong, and they will charge each candidate $100,000 RMB to give them tuition. The media showed me some fake so-called education information. So even mainland organizations know how to abuse such news to make money. You can imagine the impact on us. Of course, we know that the rumors are not true. We'll try our very best to dispel them. But let's look at the facts. For those who are trained overseas, if they are minded to practice in Hong Kong, the passing rate is rather high. There's never been difficulties for them to pass the examination. And the license examination is not unique to Hong Kong. In overseas places, for instance, after 1997, medical graduates from our two local medical schools have to sit a local license examination in the UK in order to practice. Well, Canada, US, New Zealand, and Australia, if you want to practice there, you must pass their professional license examination first. So can we call the UK irresponsible? Ireland, Australia, New Zealand, and Canada, and the US irresponsible? Because they are trying to ban medical graduates from other parts of the world to practice in the U.S. We are using double standards. Mr. Tommy Jung, your daughter, is a medical practitioner in the U.S. Even the U.S. would require overseas trained medical doctors to sit a license examination in order to ensure that doctors practicing there are up to a certain standard to help patients. Obama and Hillary, of course, do not have to consult these doctors. They have the best medical practitioners. It's just like yourself, Mr. Jung. You are wealthy enough to hire the best doctor in the world. But for most people in Hong Kong, have no choice. They have to consult doctors in the public sector. If you tell them that tomorrow there's the possibility the mechanism will be changed, they will suffer most because they do not have a choice. And therefore, the grassroots are most worried. They are worried that these changes are going to affect them directly. And secondly, Chairman, what has happened in our public hospitals? Why do we have to employ doctors with limited registration so urgently because of the high wastage rate of doctors in the HA? If you discuss with the doctors in the senior and middle tiers in the HA, they will tell you how they've suffered. They have labored for 10, 20, 30 years, and they can see how morale has gone down and how people are suffering. So the system fails to retain the senior and experienced doctors, and insurance in our professional indemnity insurance are more and more expensive, and no one are interested in the ONG specialty, and the government is not keen to really address the issues. They just introduce limited registration doctors to plug the loopholes, and they are here to shield the government from the real problems. Whenever there is a problem in talent retention, they find doctors with limited registration to plug to cover the gap. I hope this will not be a trend. Otherwise, members of the public who have no choice and who have to rely on our colleagues working very hard in the public sector will suffer. And these doctors are trying their very best to give the best service to our grassroots. Take the allocation for medical and healthcare this year. There's no increase at all. From 17% of our overall expenditure has dropped to 16.5%. And HA has seen $300 million cut from its budget. Can you imagine the feeling of frontline doctors hearing that last year they staged a sit-in in Queen Elizabeth Hospital, QEH, before they were given that two increments to put them on par with doctors in the civil service? So what kind of a system is it? Is it effective in retaining talents? The government is not trying its best to find out the problems. They resort to all sorts of means to fill the gap. Now, if we have a problem with nursing, if we have a shortage of nurses, are we going to introduce mainland nurses to cover the gaps? If the government is eager in addressing this succession problem, it should find ways to keep doctors that are being drained away from our public hospitals. You look at the system itself. Recently, doctors in Two Moon Hospital staged a lunchtime revolution. They have done their very best, but they are not given sufficient resources. They have no assistance from the administration. They are asking for a 1 hour meal time every day. Otherwise, after what rounds, they go to consultation rooms for outpatient patients, and then they go to what rounds again. There is no lunch break in between. So there's something wrong with the system. In other places, you don't have to wait. You don't have to go to see a specialist again and again. Now, after I have treated a patient as a specialist, of course, I would want the patient to receive follow-up in the community. We asked whether a prescription can be given in the community by the government, and the government says no. And in HA, well, and also OPD clinics, they have different prescriptions. So what can patients do? They can only see a doctor for a few minutes every on a quarterly basis. They have to come back for a drug prescription. So doctors know very well that they see the doctor, the patient, just to give him prescription. Well, in overseas jurisdictions, they don't do that. A specialist doctor will first treat the patient, and then he'll receive follow-up in the community by means of primary health care. And yet the administration has allowed this to deteriorate. Most patients consult a specialist doctor for medication. So doctors do not have any satisfaction, and patients ask, how come I can only receive 5 minutes of medical attention after so many months? So do you think that doctors with limited registration can fill this manpower shortage gap? If this is the attitude adopted by the government, then we cannot resolve the problem. I hope the doc, the secretary, will not blame the community because his force has caused everyone in the community to suffer. There's something wrong with his policy, and yet he's lying, and the whole community has to suffer. Can I ask Dr. KWOK Ka-ki to clarify? He said that my daughter was practicing in the U.S. and that I had I was wealthy enough not to see a public doctor. Was he referring to me, Dr. KWOK? Well, whether he is wealthy or not, he can show us his bank account book and whether his daughter has attended a license examination. I don't know. I didn't mean him. Well, he said that I don't want to help him to filibuster, and I don't mind swapping my my money with him. And the reason why I haven't consulted a public hospital because I'm not sick yet. Mr. Wong Yuk Man, this debate is on clauses with no amendments. Clauses 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 9, 12, 13, 14. I will concentrate my speech on clauses 3 and 5 of the bill. We've spent more than 2 weeks on this bill. We're close to the final stage of the bill, and we have just started the first debate in the committee stage. And I think the government should come prepared for defeat. Many members from the pro-establishment camp joined in the debate in the motion of committal. Yes, I welcome that. I don't know whether they have considered these clauses at all. Well, in 2012, when we were filibustering and at the countdown stage, pro-establishment members lined up to scold us, and I really welcomed that. All right. Clause 3, there is an amendment, and 3.2, legal advisor means a legal advisor to the council appointed under section 3B. Lay assessor means a lay person appointed under section 21B2F. Section 3B. Says that the council needs a secretary, more than one deputy secretary, and also legal advisor to be appointed by the CE. And section 5 is amended, one or more deputy secretaries and a legal advisor to be appointed by the CE. And 21B2F. To conduct the inquiry mentioned in Section 11, the Medical Council has to assess lay assessors from a panel in order to conduct an inquiry referred to in Section 11.
The MC should appoint these people as lay assessors, 4 nominated by the Department of Health, and then 11.3 changes the 4 lay members to 14, because KK Kwok is going to move a CSA. I will speak on that in the fourth debate. In 3(2), adding lay assessor and legal advisor to the interpretation clause. This is actually not a kind of interpretation, because it's actually trying to explain what is a legal advisor, and you have to go to Section 3B. So-called Section 3B means secretary, deputy secretary, and the legal advisor. Again, that is not a kind of interpretation. Interpretation means you should allow people to understand what it means, but after reading Section 3B, you just do not know the jurisdiction of the legal advisor and who these people are. But this is the way the administration always drafts the law, and then they will again say there is no problem. According to papers submitted to the Bills Committee, the legal adviser has the following functions. 1. To attend hearings of the MC and to provide legal opinion. In accordance with the ruling determination of the MC to draft the judgment for consideration of the MC, and where necessary, to provide advice for JR or appeal cases. This is number one. Number two, to attend meetings of the committees of the MC and to provide advice on the legal effect of the discussion, and if necessary, also to provide advice on minutes or other documents of the council. And number three, to help MC discharge its statutory functions, for example, registration of medical doctors and also the conduct of licensing examinations, etc. He has to provide legal advice on these and also to provide legal advice to the MC on legal actions taken by the MC and also to provide advice on journals or publications issued by the MC. I will have to take these legal advisors to task in a way because we belong to the PAC. I want to see whether they are good value for money. Recently, there have been reports telling us how much these LAs earn, and some papers have been from 2012 to 2014. The legal advisor of the MC has received $8.99 million, and he has worked for 4,700 hours for 3 years, and on average, he worked 32 hours. Ms. Chen Yunhan, are you happy about the working hours? This is lower than the standard working hours, but he is earning about $260,000 every month, or 1,900 per hour. This is in paper, CB1541(02). The victims or complainants say they wait till the cows come home for a hearing. That is why one of the purposes of the bill is to improve the complaint handling and hearing investigation mechanism. There is a big backlog of cases, and yet when the legal advisor only goes to work for 32 hours for 5 days a week, well, he has a good time indeed. Last time, I said the important thing is the hearing system. You can't shorten it just by adding people. Let us talk about the legal advisor alone. And also, if the legal advisor cannot cope with the workload, then you can hire two legal advisors. And you can lengthen the working hours of the LA from 6 to 8 hours daily. Why don't you do that? You add lay members to boost efficiency. You are putting the cart before the horse. At the hearing, well, you know that the legal advisor is important. In fact, you can improve this part of the bill. And again, coming back to the salary level of the LA, it is on the high side. Let us look at the LA of the secretariat here in the council. The entry point is about $100,000 per month. But the LA has to tackle many thorny issues, especially if you meet with members like this on cable TV. There is a documentary talking about the work of the secretariat. Once I put in 903 amendments and they really examined one by one. That is why on that day, the president told me that I should particularly thank and apologize to the staff of the secretariat. And I bowed to them. The LA of the secretariat here has to face many thorny issues, whether at panels or bills committees. They always have to provide legal advice on legal issues. And for us who know nothing about legal matters, they are a great help. They have really achieved much. And of course, they don't only work 6 hours a day, Mr. Chairman. Their hourly rate should be just a few hundred dollars. but the LA of the MC earns $1,900 an hour. The LA of the MC can still just work 6 hours a day when there is a big backlog of cases. If you, of course, work few hours but you have high efficiency, then, well, that's a different story, but that is not the case. Reality is that the LA of the MC is not efficient at all, but he has such high salaries. And he will be earning more if he works 20 hours a day, earning $1,900 an hour. In 2013, in August, 9 members of the MC co-signed a letter to the D of H complaining against the then LA of the MC that he was always late to hearings and questioned. They also questioned his high salary and also the time he usually took to write the judgments, and they asked the D of H to face up to it. And also in 2006, pediatrician Chen Heiling was ruled misconduct in a professional manner, and she was suspended from the register for 2 months, but it was a suspended sentence. And then the appeal court ruled the MC in the wrong, saying that the LA should not take part in the writing of the judgment, and the CFA ruled in favor of the MC, reinstating the professional misconduct ruling of the MC. Sorry, Mr. Wong, I can't see how what you are saying is related to the bill. Well, it has something to do with the legal advisor. Okay, it relates to the legal advisor, but how does it relate to the provisions of the bill? In a provision in the bill, please go to 3(2) to amend section 2 to add in the definitions of lay assessor and legal advisor. And I have developed the term legal advisor. This is 3(2). I think you have digressed too much. You have discovered just now? I have been speaking for 11 months. I have been very patient in listening to you. I am now of the view that you have digressed. Okay, that was only an introduction. Now I'll come to the issue of efficiency. You are trying to amend the legislation to improve efficiency, but I'm telling you, you have very low efficiency, including the low efficiency of the legal advisor. In fact, you should add the democratic element of the MC and add lay people to it, and also improve the structure of the secretariat. Those are the right things to do, but what is the meaning of these amendments? With regard to amendment to section 21 and the hearings and also the appointment of lay members, that is not going to help the efficiency of MC hearings in any way. Even if the bill is passed, you will not help improve patient interest as professed by the administration. Rather, the doctor's sector will be drawn into political disputes. I'm of the view that even if you have an interpretation of legal advisor, you will not help to explain who the legal advisor is, and the same drafting method is applied to other sections. If people are laymen, they do not understand legal matters, they will just not be able to understand these terms according to Section 2 interpretation. And as the bill is now at this stage, there is a high chance for it to be vetoed. I understand the Secretary is putting on a long face, sitting in his seat. He does not have a lot of expression on his face. He, of course, has a hard time listening to things he doesn't agree with. I will advise you here, talk to your bosses. Time is up. Do not put up a fight. I understand it. You want to give weaponry to the pro-establishment camp, saying that we are vetoing bills relating to livelihood. But if you withdraw this one, the other two bills can be carried in just 4 hours. Why do you put up a fight? You have public power. If someone moves an adjournment, then just like the copyright bill, withdraw it. Why still fight at this moment? You don't have too much time. I think just the first debate will take us to 8 o'clock or even 10 o'clock tomorrow morning, and Dr. Leung Ka-lau will move an adjournment, and then that will take 4 or 5 hours, and then there will be 4 or 5 more debates. How do you expect the bill to be supported? But the other two bills will definitely be supported. Who are on the opposite side of the people? Because this is well within your hands. It's just how you approach the matter. Everything will be fine if you just withdraw the bill. I think we are all wasting our lives by dragging this on, but you want to, of course, push the responsibility on us. Dr. Leung Ka-lau will not be returned, so dump the responsibility on him, Mr. Kenneth Leung.